Today we want to look at the next line, which says, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. When Jesus taught us to pray, and we look at this line of the prayer, Jesus is encouraging us, exhorting us, releasing us, that when we pray, we are free to come boldly to the Father with any and all issues that we are facing, any and all needs in our lives that we are facing. He's releasing us to come boldly to the Father and press into Him and ask Him and bring these things as petitions before His throne. Jesus is saying part of prayer is what we call petition. It is the idea of bringing a request. Some time ago, we had no traffic lights here outside the church building, and we never thought we'd get any. And then we had a terrible accident with the loss of a life of a young woman in the neighborhood. And so we got a petition. And many people signed that petition, sent it to the city council, and things just began to move real quickly. And so when we read this prayer, this is kind of where Jesus is saying, I want to release you, I want to free you, I want to empower you, that in areas of your lives where you have needs and they're burning on your heart and they're of concern to you, I want to encourage you, you can come to your Heavenly Father and petition Him and ask Him specifically in regards to these issues. And that's very releasing, you know, because as we get into it, you're going to realize that that really empowers you to come boldly to God. The fact that Jesus said, this is what you can do. So we're just going to break into this scripture, really, and I want to start with and break it apart and look at it. It's just a few words long, but I want to start by, can anybody smell the cinnamon buns? Yeah, that's the youth ministry there, working hard to afflict us. Daily bread going on in the kitchen. Cinnamon buns right there. Okay, so let's just go into it. So I want to go with the last phrase first, our daily bread, and just understand what Jesus really is saying that we can do when we pray. The word bread in the Bible, as in culture, in the West, maybe in Eastern cultures it would be more rice, but the word bread is a word that really... it just kind of embodies so many metaphors, right? We talk about bread in terms of money, don't we? Like, give me the dough kind of idea, right? So bread is we talk about bread in terms of necessity. We talk about bread in so many different ways. And so when Jesus says, give us this day our daily bread, what He is essentially releasing or giving us is the scope of the items that we can freely come to our Father and ask about. By using a generic term, bread, which covers so many areas of life, it's a metaphor for so many things, by using that word bread, He's essentially releasing us to come pretty much about anything in life to your Heavenly Father. When you look in the scriptures, of course, bread, first of all, is just a word that is used in regards to the necessities of life. Remember when Jesus was feeding and the 5,000, he was on the hill and the disciples came to Jesus and they said, hey, the crowd is hungry. They've been with us all day. We're going to send them away. And Jesus said, no, we're going to deal with it. We're going to do something about it. And then he prayed the prayer and he gave the people bread. And he turned to his Father, prayed a very simple prayer, broke the bread and fed the 5,000. But the key thing about that is that Jesus was actually concerned about the physical needs of the people. I mean, he turned water into wine. That's one of the most mind-blowing things in the Bible, right? Especially for, I came from a very conservative Christian background and we didn't drink when I grew up. And so they used to teach that the wine that Jesus turned into wine was non-alcoholic. It was a supernatural wine that you'd feel awesome, but you wouldn't be drunk. Okay, and everybody was saying, "Give me some of that wine. I want some of that wine." So that's what people used to teach, you know, because it's a mind-blowing miracle, isn't it? Right? You wouldn't call it a need almost. It was like a situation had come up, but it wasn't like feeding with bread. But see, Jesus, when he defines bread and he defines need, he's saying, even the wine at the wedding, I'm willing to provide. The necessities of life, the needs of life, the circumstances and situations you face, when he uses the word bread, he's saying, all of these things are legitimate and right to bring before your Father. Bread, wine, and other needs. Martin Luther, the reformist, put it this way. What is meant by daily bread? Martin Luther answers, daily bread means everything we need for our bodily well-being. Everything we need. So the word bread is about sustenance. It's about that which we need to keep us going. And so it's beyond just the concept of bread. Bring to your Father all those needs you have in your life to keep you catered for, looked after, provided for, cared for. And so Martin Luther goes on to say it could involve food, clothes, shoes. Somebody say amen to shoes. House, home, land, animals, money and goods, a godly husband, a godly wife, devout children, good workers. He's saying, listen, that even relationships, godly relationships, can be a need in somebody's life. And so it is legitimate to just come to your Father, give us this day our daily bread, and ask the Lord to provide a spouse. Some of you parents should be praying for your children. Lord, I'm praying that you would provide a godly spouse in their future so that they can, their marriage can be strong and godly. And so basically when Jesus opens it up with the bread, he's just like opening the door and saying, listen, if you have needs in your life that you've identified, I want to encourage you and release you, come and ask your Heavenly Father for it. But the Bible also uses the word bread to cover other things. In the scriptures, there's a story about a woman who came to Jesus, and Jesus was on holiday. It's a really crazy story. People, what? Jesus was on a holiday? He took a holiday to a place called Tyre and Sidon, got away from the crowds, got an apartment on the beach. He's saying, really? Yeah, it's all there in the scriptures. I'll show it to you one day. It's all there in the Greek. He's having a holiday by himself with his disciples, and this lady from the area finds out he's there, knows his reputation, and bangs on his door while he's on holiday. And as a minister, I know what it feels like, right? You're taking a rest and the door gets banged on. And Jesus said, you know what? It's not right for me to give the bread of God's children to those who are not God's children. He was testing her. And she was a woman of faith. My goodness me. And she makes this quote. She says, but Master, even the dogs eat the bread that falls from the master's table. She's talking about bread. And the thing is here is that what she wanted was a healing for her daughter. And so in this verse, healing is linked to the concept of bread. So when Jesus says to us, give us this day our daily bread, he's talking about these needs we have for the needs to live life, but he's also talking about health and well-being, that we can bring requests to our Heavenly Father for physical healing. We just had a tremendous testimony. End of the first service, somebody came up to me and a couple, and this lady brought this gentleman and said, this is my brother. Do you remember praying for him? And I kind of remembered praying for him. And yeah, I did remember praying for him. And she said, he had cancer, stage 4 cancer when he came here, and you prayed. Some other ministers prayed for him. And then she said, you know what? It's about 4 months ago, and the cancer has gone in complete remission, and we're just waiting for the results to see if it's even completely gone from his body. And I said, praise God. We serve a God who does healing work, right? God heals, right? I love their boldness. They just came. They came to the front, and they just asked God for healing. Just ask God for healing, because healing is part of the children's prayer. So Jesus is saying, in all these areas of life, I want you to come to the Father. I'm releasing you to come and ask for your daily bread, for your needs, for your physical and health well-being. Another place we see bread being used is in the area of guidance and wisdom. Remember when Jesus was facing the devil and he spoke to the devil, and the devil said to him, if you're hungry, why don't you turn these rocks into bread? And Jesus said, people don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And essentially what Jesus is comparing is bread and heavenly bread. Earthly bread is the physical needs. Heavenly bread is the word of God. Direction, guidance, the Lord speaking into our lives. And so basically, again, when Jesus says, give us our daily bread, he's saying, you can go to the Father and ask for wisdom. You can actually go to the Lord and ask for guidance. All of these things, physical necessities, health and well-being, guidance and direction from the Lord, he is saying, I want to open the door for you and let you know it is all right. You can go and ask for all of these things. You can bring specific petition, specific requests, specific needs to the Lord. And actually, he encourages us to do it. It's part of prayer. And I'm very thankful for that. We're all thankful for that, that we have access to the throne of grace. And we can bring our needs to God, and he will hear, and he will work into them. In that passage, to give us our daily bread, he also talks about the concept of this day, that it's a daily thing, that every day, Jesus says, I release you to daily come and ask the Lord to work in these areas. Now, there's often things that are pressing on our hearts, aren't there? If we were to stop for a few moments and give the microphone to every single person in this room, first of all, we'd be here at about 12 o'clock tonight. And second of all, and we said, what's on your heart? And we were all brutally honest. There would be so many different requests in this room that people need to bring before the Lord. So many here, so many in our lives, right? And so these things are pressing. I want you to just step back a little bit, though. I want you to recognize the wonder of the Lord's Prayer. Because Jesus starts by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I remembered it the second time around. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We've been learning how to pray that, right? And just if you've not been with us, I'm just going to show you what those words mean real quick, because this is really important. Our Father who's revealed in Jesus Christ. You're not like an earthly father. Your heart is revealed through Christ. And you're on the throne. You're over all things, Father. You're sovereign in all things. Hallowed be thy name. Lord, we pray today that you would make your name known in my situation, in my family's situation. You would reveal yourself. You would show yourself. That we would glorify you. We'd recognize you and we would glorify you. Your kingdom come. Lord, we pray that you would bring your authority, your leadership, you would take charge of this situation I'm praying over. And Father, I'm praying that your will be done. In this situation, accomplish your will. Don't let anything break your will. You have a will in this circumstance, Father. Bring that will about. That's how Jesus says you start your prayer. Okay? So let's just say for a moment, you got a need, and I just thought in the first services, we'll go with the same one here. Let's just imagine you have a car, and you're on a tight budget, and your car breaks down, and you take it into the mechanic, and the mechanic said it's going to be a $2,000 fix. And then you're in this dilemma of, do I fix it, or do I buy a new one, but I don't have cash for a new one, and it's going to put me in debt. And so these are the dilemmas of life. And so what Jesus is saying is we come to pray, we first of all say, Father, thank you that your heart is revealed to me. I just pray in this situation with my vehicle that you would reveal yourself, Father. In the midst of the circumstance, whatever happens, let me know you more through the circumstance. Let me understand you more. Reveal your name and your glory to me through the situation that I could praise you. Father, I give the situation over to you. Your kingdom come. I'm putting you in charge, Father. I'm inviting you to take leadership in this circumstance with this vehicle. Begin to work in it. And Father, I pray that in the midst of the situation, nothing would stop your will from being done. You have a purpose and you're going to accomplish it. Lord, I pray that you would begin to do that in this situation. Now, what do you notice? By the time you're finished praying that, you're not going to, you almost feel like you don't need to pray anymore. Right? Basically, as we pray the Lord's Prayer and we start with God first and God's glory and God's purposes and God's will first, you will find many of the things that we think are big needs become small needs because we know God is in charge. We know God is working. And so often we come in with our need first, and all that does sometimes is make the need bigger. We've got to come in first and glorify God and recognize God and invite God in and lay our desire and our heart down and say, God, above everything that I want your will to be done. And when we have that position in our hearts and that position in our lives, you're going to find that many of the things that you thought were really, really weighty actually get way less weighty because you've handed it over to the Lord in the Spirit first. So Jesus says when you do it. So he says, come this day, Lord, every day. These are the issues that I'm facing. Now, of course, there are situations we face that even after praying positioning ourselves in Christ and God first, the beating and the weight of it still was there. This week we got a call from Jim Barrett's family, and earlier this week, late last week actually, he had a stroke. and a heart situation. And so he ended up in hospital and he was in a coma, a member of our church. And the family called us, and so we prayed for them on Tuesday as a group. And, you know, that's a pressing need. That's a need that's really burning on our heart. And we said, Lord, you know, come into the situation, take charge, work in the situation. But then we said these very key words, but Father, what we are asking for you to do in this circumstance is bring healing. We specifically asked for the pressing need that was on our heart. And one of the things I prayed simply was that, Lord, Jim is an amazing guy. And Father, he's the leader in his family. He's really influential in getting people into the faith in his family. And Father, we just pray that you would restore his health because he still has a work to do to bring his family into the faith fully. So we just feel, Father, it's not his time. We pray for healing in his situation. Went to visit him a few days later, and he was sitting up, and he was doing great. And I said, praise be to God, because he could have easily gone the other way. Our Father in heaven is at work in his life. Amen. It's pretty exciting stuff. And so we have these needs in our lives. And Jesus is releasing us. He says to us, listen, they're pressing, and the things that you may need to pray for daily, and I want to encourage you to do so and bring them specifically, and God is able to work. Apostle Paul makes these famous lines, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, we get that word petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Now, there's one little thing I want to say before we move on about this, this idea of bringing our requests to God daily. One of the big things that God wants to accomplish, see, prayer is not just about, again, getting. Prayer is about being transformed. It's communication, it's relationship. And when we pray God's way, the thing that begins to happen is that we begin to get changed. Now, if we daily are coming to God and putting our dependency upon him. By the prayers we pray, we're submitting and depending on him once again. The thing that God is wanting to do through this is to change our heart from a heart of independence to a heart of dependence upon God. If we are going to go anywhere in our Christian faith, if we are going to be used in any way beyond where we are now, we have to become a people who are dependent upon God and not on our own resourcefulness to get where God wants to take us. We live in a society, don't we, where everything is pretty much taken care of. I know that people have poverty. I know that people have struggles. But listen, there is free schooling for the most part. There is healthcare for the most part. There is, there's different things out there to help people. And there's jobs around. And so we live. So for many people, to be honest, for most of life, you don't need God. You could live it. You can live it independently. It's only when crisis has come that we seek to ask God for help. But Jesus is saying, listen, daily, I want you to acknowledge your dependency on God for everything in your life, for the necessity of life. For this reason, at some stage, God would love to ask you, I'm going to shock you, so get ready. He would like to ask you to give your car away. He would like to ask you to give a gift of $500 to the person sitting next to you. Everybody say amen, so the person next to you knows they give $500 would be good. He wants to get you to the place that you would leave your job and go and serve other people. What's my point? God wants to grow dependency. We will never be able to do those things if our security is in what we have been able to do. But if we have learned that he is our provision and he is our supply and he is the one who gives me my daily bread, and like he said, like the birds of the air and the lilies of the field, I do not have to worry about tomorrow. I have fully put my trust in God. I know how to go to him daily. Therefore, my money is not my own. It is the Lord. So this prayer is about breaking independence. It's about moving from a people who are so lined up and wanting what we want, and that's okay, Jesus said, do it, to being a people who are growing in our dependence on God and our trust in God so that we are freed up. Now, I'm sowing that little seed now. You don't have to accept it. You can just put it to the side right there. That's pretty hard. We're going to be looking at money in the month of March. March money month. And we're going to get back to this. That there's a work that God wants to do in our lives of freeing us from our dependence upon our own ability to do things and beginning to lean on God daily. I'm coming to you. My dependence is in you. Because when you have that kind of dependence in God, faith in God, God can use you in so many ways because you're not holding tightly. Can I hear an amen to that? Lastly, give us this day. I want to look at the beginning of the passage. So Jesus is saying, listen, anything is there. I want you to ask the Lord about pretty much anything. I want you to ask daily. I want you to really realize that it's okay to put your dependency in him, to trust in him. And then he starts that whole thing by saying, give us. And it's that word give us that I really want to center on as we come to the end. Give us. It's the idea, the word give us is like a bold demanding, a bold request. When Jesus says, ask for daily bread, he is saying, ask boldly for daily bread. Ask boldly for those things you need. He says here in the scripture, the verb being used, give, in the Lord's Prayer, and this is from Daryl Johnson. The verbs of the Lord's Prayer, hallow, come, be done, give, forgive, lead not, and deliver, are all in the imperative mood. What is the imperative mood? As one person puts it, the imperative is a mood of command or entreaty, a mood of volition. The imperative carried with it a very forcible tone of command. The ancient Greeks so regarded it and hence never employed it in the imperative communication with superiors. It's just like a very demanding give. When Jesus says, give us this day our daily bread, it's like, give us, give us, give us this day. It's demanding. And you would think, well, that's a bit strong. But Jesus is teaching us how to pray. And he's the one telling us to be a people who are bold when we come and pray. Sometimes, if you've got teenage children, they might come and say, Dad, I need money. And it's not really, Dad, I need money, may I? It's, Dad, give me the money. What was that movie? Show me the money, right? Show me the money. Show me the bread. Show me the dough, right? Give me the money. It's a confidence. It's an expectation. It's kind of a demanding. But what's interesting, if you look at the New Testament and you look at Jesus and you look at his interaction with people, he loved the people who came boldly. He really did. He are the ones that he really locked into. That woman who wanted the daughter healed on his holiday, not leaving until he gets it. He says, she's a woman of great faith. The woman with the issue of blood, she's a woman of great faith. The guys who broke open the roof and lowered their paraplegic friend through the ceiling, this is a person of great faith. But do you notice the theme there? Jesus loved those who boldly came to God because they knew he was a father, expecting that God could do. They brought their petitions boldly to the Father. Jesus often said, ask and keep on asking. Knock and keep on knocking. Seek and keep on seeking. Bring your petitions to your heavenly Father. There's a story in the Bible about a woman who had to see a judge to get a just decision. And the story is about the fact that the woman would not leave. She just stayed there and kept pressing in until she got what she needed from the judge. And Jesus said, if that's the judge who was wicked would do that, how much more will your heavenly Father who is great do that in your lives? And so Jesus really encourages us that when we come and pray, that we are to be bold in the way we ask. We're just to come and we're just to ask and we're just to ask with boldness. We, after the service today, we had a family come up and a young lady's really struggling with cancer at the moment. And we just agreed together and we boldly asked God for healing. How can you do that, Pastor? Because that's what Jesus said to do. He said to boldly ask for bread, daily bread. We need a miracle here, Lord. I'm boldly asking. Now, I want to release you. Oh, yeah. Woo, I'm going to take my jacket off. We're going to take it up a notch. It's quite hot in here. My wife says no, but it's quite hot in here. And I want to keep you with me because we're right at the end. We're right near the end here. But this is This is, to me, one of the crucial points Jesus is making in this prayer. My experience as a pastor is that most people really struggle with coming boldly to God and just asking. And it's not a condemnation. It's I think a lot of it has to do with a respect for God, and a fear that it seems over the top. It seems too familiar. It seems it just doesn't quite seem right. I get that, right? Some of us have questions about, is my request really worthy? It seems so frivolous compared to people starving in Africa. I'm asking for this job, and there's much greater, it just doesn't seem like they're on the same scale, so how could I even be asking this kind of way? I think other people really struggle with the idea about, but is this God's will? Like, praying for to get married. I'd like to have a godly husband. Lord, I'm praying that you provide me a godly husband. But then in the back of your mind, but maybe it's God's will for you not to be married. So you struggle with God's will. And is what am I praying for really in God's plan and God's purpose? And I think because of all of those things, people really struggle to pick this one up and to pray and just ask directly to the Heavenly Father for their daily needs as they see their daily needs to be. So here's what I want you to grasp. I'm going to go back up on the platform. Strategic moment. So the drama can increase. Here's what I want you to grasp. This request, Father, I am asking for this issue. Father, give us our daily bread. Father, work into the situation, asking that you do this for me. That request is encapsulated in the whole prayer. It almost goes without saying that when you pray that, you have already positioned yourself in alignment with God. You start the prayer by saying, your glory, your will, your kingdom. And I want to say that this prayer is not just about praying. If we pray this kind of lines regularly and expand on them regularly in our lives, I've been finding, I don't know if you've been finding in the last weeks, I've been praying all the time. Father, your kingdom come. Father, you do your will. Father, you establish yourself. Lord, you take charge. Lord, you reveal yourself. I find myself praying there all the time. So I am positioning myself in my state in Christ, it's a foregone conclusion. The first thing I want before the healing is that God's will be done. The first thing I want before the healing is for God to take charge and do what he wants to do. The first thing I want above everything, no matter what happens, is that God be glorified. I want you to get that. So when I come to pray, I am already positioned in an attitude and a spirit that says, above everything else, no matter what does or does not happen, my heart's greatest desire is that God be glorified, that God be revealed, that God be known. That's what my heart is. That's what I desire for. That's what I long for. So then when I come with a request, I pray that request boldly, knowing that my request is still under the greater request. I'm not going to try and work out whether this fits into God's will. I'm just going to do what Jesus says. Ask, knowing that God is going to do his will. Do you follow what I'm saying? No, I have no idea what you're going on about, Pastor. Perfect. Okay. Dick, you're in the sermon this morning, brother. You look nervous. I'm just going to pray for you.
Okay.
But I don't know if you've got any needs. So we're just going to pray that, pretending that you have a bad leg. Do you have a bad leg?
No, they're both excellent.
Excellent legs. That's very good to hear. But I'm going to pray as if you have a bad leg.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. So I don't want you leaving here with a bad leg. I'm just going to pray that you're pretending that you are getting prayed for. I would hate for you to be praying and have a worse leg.
I'm sure you'd be.
Yeah, they are. Okay. So listen, I'm praying for healing, because healing's a great way to walk this through. And I'm praying for Dick. So I'm just going to pray, like I did for the people with cancer this morning. I just take Jesus' word. Father, I pray for Dick right now. It's my desire, Father. It's our desire, Father. We just be honest. This is what we desire for, Lord. You don't have to explain it away. This is what we desire for, Lord. We desire, Father, that you bring healing to his leg. Father, we become before your throne and we ask you, give us our daily bread, Father. Bring healing to his body. Bring healing to his leg in Jesus' precious name. I just ask. I don't try and work out all the calculations. I just ask. Because I know that as I've walked in my life, my heart is always, let your will be done. My heart is always, reveal yourself. So when I pray it, now if you feel more comfortable, you can say at the end of saying that, Lord, heal, but your will be done. You can say that if it makes you feel more in line with the scripture. But in your heart, we know that already because we've been praying that regularly. So therefore, it releases us to boldly ask. So what I'm saying to you is, don't get all confused in your head. Just ask. God, if we're submitted to God and we're happy for his, we're keen for his will to be done, we want his will to be done, God will provide the answer. Our job is just to ask. Okay, Lord, give us this day our daily bread. And let your kingdom come, Lord. And let your will be done, Lord. And let your name be glorified. So if he doesn't give what we've asked for and we've asked boldly, we are confident God is at work. We are confident that God is moving. We're confident that God is bringing things together. This is how Jesus prayed. This is how Paul the Apostle prayed. Let's look at Jesus' prayer in Mark chapter 14. Going a little further, he fell to the ground and prayed that if it is possible, the hour might pass from him. Verse 36, I love the intimacy of Jesus. Abba, Father. Abba means like Daddy God, Daddy Father. He's so intimate. Abba, Father, he says, everything is possible for you. Everything is possible for you. Turn to your neighbor and say, everything is possible for God. Everything. That's what Jesus said. He starts his prayer and he acknowledges the power of God and he says, Lord, I'm bringing my request to you. I know everything is possible for you. So I'm just going to ask. And he asks, take this cup from me. Jesus knows the Father wants him to go to the cross. Jesus knows what his destiny is. But right now in his humanity, he is asking what he desires in his humanity is not to face the suffering. It's a very open, it's a very raw prayer. This is a very raw prayer. He's just asking and sharing his heart and saying, Father, take this cup away. Take this road of suffering away. But then he says, after he's prayed that prayer, but not my will be done, but your will be done. Father, this is what I want. And you've encouraged me that I can be open and honest with you and I can share what I want. But it's not a demand in the sense that I share what I want, I ask for what I want, but I always say, Lord, but let your will be done. This is what I want, and I'm boldly asking for it. But Father, your will be done. And the Father did not take the cup away. Let me invite the worship team. Paul the Apostle prayed the same kind of prayer. Paul the Apostle, one time the Bible says, he says in the Corinthians that he was afflicted. We don't know what the affliction was. He said he was afflicted by Satan. We don't know whether it was a physical ailment. We don't know whether it was somebody who was chasing him. We don't know whether it was a mental health, a depression. We don't know what it was that was afflicting Paul. And the Bible says Paul just went. He said, I went to the Father three times and just asked, Father, heal me. Father, remove this. Take this away. He asked just what he wanted. He asked what he needed. And then at the end of it, it's interesting, he didn't get a response. But after the third time, he got a voice from God saying, my grace is sufficient for you. He asked God. He didn't get exactly what he wanted, but he still got God working and glorifying himself in the situation.